Good morning, everyone. So welcome to the first session of the day. So I'll introduce a system called GRIL, a unified analytics platform. So before that, I am Amareshwari. I work as an architect in data platform team at InMobi. And I've been working in Hadoop and ecosystem since 2007. And I'm Apache Hadoop PMC member and Apache Hive committer. And before InMobi, I was working with Yahoo for 5 years. So that's my background. So we'll see what I'm going to cover today. So I'll introduce how InMobi is using analytics in its business, and then what problems it is facing and why we have built a platform at InMobi for analytics. So I'll introduce the platform GRIL, and then the OLAP model that is built in for GRIL, and then some examples we'll see, and then I'll spend some time on the design of the GRIL, and then I'll conclude. So InMobi is a digital advertising company which actually advertises ads on your phone, the smartphones and tablets, right? So so what it does is it provides a marketplace. So out there are app developers and publishers or other websites who actually are owning the space on your phone, right? And then the advertisers who wants to actually sell their business, and phone is a medium that they want to use. So InMobi is providing a marketplace where it buys the real estate on your phone, and then it serves the ads from the advertisers that they want to show. So in between all this, InMobi is actually acquiring the user. So it's understanding which apps the user is interested in, and it is understanding more about the user, so that it can actually show better ads to the user and make money to all, both to publishers and also to advertisers. And in between, it gets the share from both. So that is the main business of InMobi. Then we'll see more on the analytics use cases. So there are many personas at InMobi who wants to use analytics. So there are advertisers and publishers, and there are account managers who manage specific accounts, sort of things. So there they want to actually do analytics on a UI-based platform. They don't want to write programs or run queries on a system sort of things. They will just go to the UI, look what is happening. For example, an advertiser will log in every day and see how many ads were shown and how much he could reach, how many users he could reach in a day. And a publisher wants to log in and see how many ads are published on his page and how much he could earn. So on a daily basis, they want to track what is happening to their business. And their account managers who are looking at specific accounts, looking at what is happening over a week, over a month, over a day, sort of thing. And there are business and product analysts who are analyzing the business from end to end. Like they are seeing what has happened to the revenue end to end, or if there is a new product that has come, how the product is performing over all the business. Or they can be only looking at a particular geolocation and how that product is performing in this geo, sort of thing. And then there are data scientists in InMobi who wants to actually understand the user. So understand trends and infer more about what is happening in the business. And then they want to do forecasting, or if there are any anomalies, so they'll try to do that. And there are engineering systems themselves who wants to get feedback into them from what has happened. So if you are performing how we are performing over the day and then what should I do next day. So the engineering systems are built on top of what, how we are performing by ourselves. So there are feedback systems like ad relevance. So whether ad is relevant to the user or not. And then there are developers themselves who wants to actually go deep into what is happening to the business. So these are the broad use cases where analytics are happening. So if we categorize these use cases, so there is a broadly categorized into canned or dashboard queries where it is the canned ones are where you have fixed few fields and you're showing a dashboard to the user where he'll just go look at it or drill down on the page or and like do it more, some more interactions on the page. Or there are ad hoc queries where a random user comes and he wants to file his own query. And there are interactive, and both of these have flavors of interactiveness, ad hoc and the canned queries, and can be batch based as well. So I what I meant by batch based queries is you're not looking at a smaller amount of data. If you are looking over a month of data, you can't have it in the interactive fashion. So you would fire the query, then go back, and then come back and look at the result, because a query over a month of data won't be answered in few seconds or minutes. So there are scheduled queries where the users who wants to run a particular query, say every first day of the week, every Monday of the week, and see how the performance was over the last week, right? And there are users who wants to run some queries, say every first of the month, and to see actually what happened over the last month. So such queries, and they'll have to remember and run it every day or every week or every month. So such queries, they can just schedule it and then go back to their usual work. And if an email comes into their inbox saying that, okay, today's performance is this, or last week's performance is this. So that is what they want. And the data scientist wants to actually infer some insights through the machine learning algorithms that you'd see throughout the conference. So to achieve all these use cases, InMobi has many warehouses in its system. So it has like 170 TB of Hadoop-based warehouse and a 5 TB of SQL-based columnar data warehouse. And then it has 70 TB of HBase cluster. So, and actually the scale at which InMobi works is it serves billions of ads, ad impressions per day. So, so all the data will be put in this warehouse for the users to query. So why they're both Hadoop and SQL? So this is a bigger question, but I'll try to put it in one slide and we'll try to understand, but there can be a bigger talk on just why we need Hadoop and SQL together. So the world has understood that we need both Hadoop and SQL together. We can't just live with Hadoop alone or SQL warehouse alone, because when you look at a query that is coming, you have things like some queries which would scan very less data and can respond in a millisecond, sub-second latency, but the queries which would scan little more data might come in a minute or so. But if the queries which are scanning a lot of data will take a few minutes or hours to finish it. So for the queries that can be answered with sub-second latency, Hadoop is not the system. Right? So even there are improvements happening in Hadoop, so it's not there yet, because Hadoop will be scan-based and it will be a process that will be launched, which itself will take, for the launching itself, it will take a few seconds. So those queries can't be answered by Hadoop. So we would need a SQL data warehouse to answer such queries. So we have categorized such queries as canned queries, where you have the fields, the fixed number of fields, and then put them in a data warehouse and just hit it to answer it. So which that is where you can mix both your Hadoop warehouse and SQL warehouse. So this is what is there at InMobi. And then, so what are the problems that InMobi is facing? So there are multiple systems. So one is based out of Hadoop, one is based out of Columnar Data Warehouse, and there are three different systems that users go to and then run their queries. So that is, first of all, that is confusing for them. Where should I go to get an answer for my query, right? And then, even though the systems are built, so they can talk to just one storage. So Hadoop-based system can talk to only Hadoop HDFS, and the other one can talk to only the Columnar Data Warehouse. So even if the user who has gone to the Columnar Data Warehouse system cannot get an answer to his query, even though data is available in Hadoop, because that system can't understand what Hadoop is, and vice versa. So they want to make use of the data available there, but they can't use it. And then the schema management becomes hard, right? So when you have so many systems, if you have to add a new field, new column which is exposed to the analytics, you'll have to go modify each system independently. And for the end user to see that there is a new attribute that he can query, it takes at least a month for all the systems to like make it available, like end-to-end test it, and finally make it available to the user. So, and moreover, there is a big SQL and Hadoop community building out there. So we are not making use of that. So there are interactive queries also getting answered in Hadoop with newer things, things in Hadoop that are coming up. So Grill is born to solve all these problems, to provide a unified analytics platform. So I'll introduce Grill here. So the two goals of Grill is provide analytics as service. So the first one is provide analytics as service, and then unify the query layer and catalog layer. So what do I mean by analytics as service? So what it wants to provide is that if there is any team, any business that is holding some data, create schema for your data and then open it up for analytics. And then all your queries are also can come as the service APIs that it provides. Actually very similar to your AWS, right? AWS provides you S3 as a file system, which is a service where you can hit it with all REST APIs. So Grill wants to achieve something on something like that from the analytics side. So where you create new tables, or update things, and then our fire queries through the API. And then the other goal is to actually unify the catalog and the query layer for all the things like that we have just seen, right? All ad hoc and canned queries, or batch and interactive queries. So on a single interface, so that your user shouldn't be worried that, okay, if it is in SQL warehouse, I should go write a SQL query to hit the data warehouse and write a MapReduce program to read things from Hadoop. So here is a simple architecture of Grill, where in the middle of this we are seeing the Grill server, which is providing you endpoints for the user. Like it is providing the REST API for all queries and the schema updates that you have. So, and there can be CLI and Java client or JDBC client built on top of it. Our applications can directly talk REST API. And then there can be other bigger applications built on top of it, or a bigger UI built on top of it, or a complicated system like the ad relevance engine we are talking about, so that can be built on top of it, which will issue a query through REST API. And then Grill server is backed by something called OLAP Metastore, that we'll see what the OLAP model is available in Grill in the coming slides. And it is built on top of Hive Metastore, if you have already heard of it. So what Hive provides is actually, it catalogs the data. Hive Metastore or Hcatalog, that what it does is it catalogs the data that is available on Hadoop. So where the data is available as tables. So we are building OLAP model on top of it. And then Grill server is backed by a driver. So each driver here is actually any execution engine that can talk SQL-like language. For example, for talking to Hadoop, we use Hive engine. And then for talking to DB, we use a JDBC engine. And it can be anything like Shark or Impala as well. If you have heard of those are also, those also accept Hive QL languages to do analytics on the data. So and there can be storages coming down your driver, which can be HDFS or HBase or a columnar data warehouse or S3 or a Redshift database that you have. So you can add a new storage as long as actually you have a driver which can answer, which can read data from that storage. So if there is no driver which can talk to that storage, we can actually plug in the driver which can talk to that. So before I build up our OLAP model, I want to give a typical data layout of how you will store your fact data and dimension data. So what is fact data? Fact is something that has occurred, an event that has occurred. For example, in the case of InMobusiness, that it has served an ad on a phone. It's an event that has occurred, right? So what we'll represent is, okay, InMobi has served an ad on a particular phone at this time of the day, at this location, and the device type is, say, an iPhone, and it served a, say, Nike ad on your phone. So what is the ad shown, and when is it shown, and how long it took to render it? So that is an event that has occurred. So what we are trying to capture is that data in a table. So how do you put that in a table? Is actually, you will represent that as some dimension cuts and some measurable quantities. So we are calling them the dimension cuts and measures here. So then we have all the raw data coming. So at InMobi scale, it is a billion ads that are getting served. So there'll be billion entries that, okay, where each ad is served and associated parameters with it, right? And now if one business analyst wants to query, and if we hit this data, it's going to be huge. And in every day, we have so much data coming. So this is if you hit raw data for everything, it's going to be huge. So how to solve that is actually build an aggregated fact on top of your raw data, where you are dropping some dimensions, and then and some measures as well. So how do you decide like which measures and dimensions to drop is actually what you're interested in. Like there might be many parameters associated with the ad that we're talking about, but are you interested in all of them? There are around 500 parameters associated with a single ad that is served, but what is the final user interested in? So that is what makes the aggregated facts. So which are of more interest, pull them up. So when you're pulling them up, and measurable quantities can't just be pulled up, right? So they'll, if you're dropping a dimension, then the others have to be rolled up or aggregated on the dimension, when we're dropping the dimensions. So then you can build many aggregated facts on top of it. So it in my case, we have around like 5 aggregated facts on the raw data that are getting built. And from the top of the pyramid, we answer about like 70% of the queries, and we don't hit the raw for all the queries. And the other angle to the pyramid that you are just seeing here is the time. So once you have decided that I want to group these measures and dimensions together into single aggregate facts, you can store that in a monthly roll-up, or a daily roll-up, or an hourly roll-up. So where your data is available on a monthly granularity, or a daily granularity, or an hourly granularity. And when a query comes, you want to answer it from the top of the pyramid and on the time dimension which is of low cost. For example, the monthly fact answered from a monthly query answered from a monthly fact will be faster than picking up 30 days of daily data for the same. So this is the typical fact data layout that you see in the other data warehouses as well, like the columnar traditional data warehouses. So and then what is dimension data? So dimension data is something describing your things, like for example the location. So you can have the location which is associated with more params, like which city it is, what are its interesting points, is it like crowded, how much population is there. The more things associated with a domain. So it's more like a domain data, you can call it. So and this data is not a fact data. It is actually not an event sort of thing that has occurred, right? So it is describing about the domain. So and this data is actually a slow changing data. It don't change every day. Your population of the city might increase in a week or over a month if you're looking at, but it don't increase. It won't be updated every day, every hour, every second sort of thing. So here also what we have is all the attributes associated with the domain. But again, if we hit this this raw data for all the queries, you are again going to incur cost. So there are cases where you would actually build a subset of the fields that are available on your raw. So what we do here is just drop the columns. So there is no aggregation happening while you're dropping. So you're just dropping some fields. For example, population, I'm not interested going up. I'm interested in city and its interest points. What is it famous for? So you might drop population and just keep interest points is at one level and use that to answer your queries. So again here, when a user query comes, we would like to answer it from the top of the pyramid than from the bottom of the pyramid. So how are the fact data and dimension data related? So this is the typical relation between fact and dimension data. So where in your fact data, you'll not actually store the actual dimension fields there. So you'd actually keep the keys, which can refer to a bigger dimension table, like more like a foreign key in RDBMS. So which can refer to that and join with that and get. So this is a data warehouse model of storing your big data. So if you have heard of SQL and Hadoop, the first thing that comes to mind is Hive, right? So but why does Hive itself is not enough? Why did we build Grill? What is Hive giving and what is it not giving? So what does Hive provide is it associates structure to the data that is even present in a file system. It provides a catalog-like service called HCatalog, and it provides pluggable storage interface where it can actually talk to the other systems. And it is not actually SQL, but SQL-like, which is called HQL, the HiveQL, and it is adopted by other systems as well. And there is strong Apache community sitting out there who is building Hive out. So, but what is missing? So, what we want to actually represent is the pyramids that we have just seen and the snowflake relationship between the tables that we have. So, what Hive provides right now is just simple table with rows and columns. What we want to say is, all the data that is sitting out there in your warehouse is not simple tables with rows and columns. They're related. They're related to each other in a way that one is an aggregated fact that is built on top of and some other thing. And the fact table can refer to a dimension and a domain data with some keys where there is a relationship between them. So what we are saying is your data, the tables in your data warehouse are related. And we want to capture that relationship in your schema so that every user need not know that relationship. And now when we have multiple storages like the traditional warehouse and Hadoop together, what we want to have is the logical schema. What I have designed is this, and I can store the same thing on Hadoop as well as same thing on a traditional warehouse. And what is missing is the pluggable execution engine like a DB engine where it can just go talk to the DB and serve the query. And other features like query lifecycle management where you can build more features on top of your queries like query caching. If the same query comes again, I have the result ready. I'll just serve it to you. And when it is shared across so many people, you need some sort of quota management so that your system is not eaten up by just one person. It is used properly by all your stakeholders. And then the ability to schedule queries, as we have seen that people want to fire a schedule and forget about it, and the result comes to them every month or every day, every week's thing. So we would like to build all the missing parts in Grill. That is what is Grill adding. So we'll see more on the OLAP model here. So what Grill adding is three basic construct on top of Hive. It is providing something called cube, and another thing called dimension, and storage. And what is cube? Cube here is which is consisting of our dimension cuts and measures that we have seen in our data layout. And dimension is consisting of all the attributes of a domain. And storage is a storage endpoint that you have, like your DB or a Hadoop distributed file system. And cube consists of something called fact table. So when we are calling it a table here, the fact table is the table with list of columns where we are saying the order of the columns is this. So when we are talking it as a cube, we haven't enforced any order. It is all set of fields that are available for you to go query. So when you have to query query something, you don't have to know the order of how it is stored. So, and that can be inside a table, which is our fact table here. But what you're exposing to the user is just the cube. And you can build like one layout for your HDFS and another layout for your data warehouse as your fact table. And similarly for dimension also. So what we are exposing to the user is all the attributes that can be queried through the dimension data and then the dimension table corresponding to the table of it. So what does a cube contain? So it has measures, dimensions, dimension attributes and and expression on top of them. So measure is the English word measure, actually, anything that is measurable. And when we are talking about measure here, so you will associate a name and type to it, and the default aggregate, if it is actually picked up in your pyramid in the last on the last slide that you have seen. And then the dimension attributes can be simple dimension attribute, which is a name and column, or a referenced attribute, which is actually pointing to another dimension, or a hierarchical dimension where it is actually something like location. So where we have like zip code, city, state, country, and region, and you can store any one of those in your fact. And a time dimension where you can have time ranges associated with your queries. And expressions are any complicated expression that you want to build on top of this, you can store that in the metastore so that everyone need not remember the expression for or the complicated formula that you're calculating. So some of the concepts here are borrowed from Mondrian, if you're familiar with. So and for dimension, so we have again attributes and expressions. Attributes are again the same simple and referenced or hierarchical. So if we see the relationships, a cube will refer to a dimension, and dimension can refer to dimension down. And a fact table belongs to a cube. Then what we are saying is cube is consisting of fact tables. And fact table can be present on multiple storages. A dimension table belongs to a dimension, and dimension can consist of multiple dimension tables. And dimension table is present on storages. So to map this data model to the earlier layout that we have seen, so the bigger pyramid, we are calling it cube, and each box there, we are calling it a fact table. And each fact table is referring to a dimension. Sorry, the cube is referring to dimension. Dimension can have again dimension tables. So these are all the logical schema that you have just built. And the tables here can be present on any storage. So you can associate a storage with the tables here. So now we'll see a couple of examples. Okay, so before that, what is the language that we are providing for the cubes that we have just built? So it is still SQL. Almost SQL, so we are adding a word cube in the front to differentiate it from the other queries which go to the base tables. So we are calling it cube select with the select expressions from a table reference and with where, and then there is a time range function that is getting used to specify the time range that you are looking for, then the group by, having, and order by, and limit. So let us see an example. So here the user wants to actually get all the city names from your city domain that you have. So Grill has actually looked at that query and it has figured out, okay, city table is present on a storage C2, where I can pick up that table, C2_city table, or it is present on a system like a file system. So if you have to store a dimension data on file system, because it is slow changing data, what you do is actually snapshot it every hour or every day, sort of thing. And then, Grill would figure out that, okay, it is getting snapshotted. So it is saying that, okay, I'm picking up C1 city table, where I'm picking up the latest partition of that city table. So we'll see one more query. So here, what user is asking is, for each city, give me the measure MSR2 from the test cube for 2 days of range. It is March 10th, 3rd hour to March 12th, 3rd hour. So Grill has looked at this query and it has figured out, okay, I have to pick up C2 test fact to answer this. And then there is a relationship between the test cube and city that it has added, the inner join city table with city. And it has seen that, okay, it has to actually pick up some few hourly partitions and a daily partition to answer your query. So it can, because the range that is given is of 2 days, and in between there is like one full day that you can, I can just go get the fact data from a daily roll up and answer the query. And for city table itself, it picked the latest data of it and it is added a group by for your city name. Yeah. So I'll have to, I think, wrap up. I'll brief on the design part we are doing. Like, yeah. So if you have to add a new engine, so you have to implement an interface which is explain, execute, and fetch results. Or if a new query comes to Grill engine where you have multiple execution engines, what does Grill do? So it will rewrite the query for each execution engine, the rewrite that we just seen, and get the cost from each of the engine, and then pick up the execution engine with least cost. So this is more on the Grill server design. So the REST API is given by the Jack Saras, and then we have authentication and authorization getting built for all the services that it provides, and metrics and statistics for all the services it provides. And there are services like session, query, metastore, and scheduler. So query service is where you can fire your queries and track them and list all your queries. And then a metastore service will provide all the CRUD for your cube dimension and storages, and then add storage to fact table and add partitions to your storage tables. So it will provide all the CRUD there. And then the session service provides you where you have you open a session, you add some configurations, you add some jars, they're available throughout your session. So that will be available not only in the shell, but as the REST API will be available to you from the session service. And then there will be event service which can talk to all the services and so that they can exchange messages. The current state of Grill is the query, metastore, and metrics are available. Statistics and scheduling queries are in progress. And the client and execution engines are done. So what is coming out is, we are looking to normalize the query cost across engines, and then load balance actually across engines. Even though the cost on one of the engines is slow, and but if it is more loaded, we want to give the query to the other. And then we want to have altering your schema, which can actually percolate to all the storages that it has. And then authentication and authorization. And then we're building up a machine learning service as well, and as part of Grill, where you can build models on top of your queries. And then the quota management. So here are the references. Grill is already open sourced from InMobi. It is available under GitHub, InMobi, github.com, InMobi Grill. So, and it is well documented. You can have a look at it. And the mailing list open. You can go mail it, post on the mailing list anytime. And soon we are incubating into Apache. So mostly in a month we'll be incubating into Apache. So if you're interested in contributing to open source, you're always welcome to contribute. Yeah, so that's what I have open to questions.
Ms. Amareshwari, ladies and gentlemen, do you have any questions? It's time for questions. If you have questions, you can put your hand in the air. We'll have someone come and hand out a mic to you. We'll go with you, sir.
Yeah, you have talked about cubes. You could have explained as what is a cube in terms of shifting the dimensions. Like if you have time and location and category in X, Y, Z axis, when you turn the cube around, it will be the opposite. Instead of time and location and category, it will be category, location, and time. So that is the concept of multidimensional cube. I wrote a textbook on this. Then many OLAP servers, like Microsoft SQL Server has an OLAP server. It takes care of all this query processing of the OLAP queries on the regular database of the SQL Server.
Yeah.
So there are things like BigSQL where, you know, Postgres query SQL queries are converted into Hadoop big data queries and back. So when that happens, the effect is similar to what you are describing in Grill. Things are already happening in that direction. That's what I'm saying.
So there are proprietary solutions, but we haven't found a open source solution which is gathering both of them.
No, there's a thing called BigSQL. I don't know if you heard about it.
BigSQL PixSQL doesn't talk to a traditional data warehouse. So here we are talking about unifying both traditional warehouse and Hadoop.
So in other words, you are converting the Hadoop data, you're not converting, but you're keeping them two separate and processing
yes.
separately.
Oh, we're going to hand the mic this side, please.
What's your comment on the PrestoDB? Would it have solved the problem or what were the limitations?
Pardon?
PrestoDB? PrestoDB is doing something similar to what Grail is trying to achieve. Would it have solved the problem?
So I'll have to check what is PrestoDB doing. But so what Grail wants to achieve is give data warehouse features on top of Hadoop data as well. And then have single unified interface for both your DB and Hadoop queries.
Okay, we have a question to the right and then forward here. You can hand the mic there, please.
Hi. So you talked about the dimension pack tables and all. Do you have any, can you give any insights into what are the levels of dimension you are working with for ad hoc queries as well as pre-aggregated queries?
At InMobi, we have around 125 domain data, dimension data, dimension tables, which are both sitting in Hadoop warehouse and also in a columnar data warehouse. That is what you are looking
at. Yeah, yeah. So what's the cardinality, maximum and minimum cardinality you are playing with?
So there are things like the creatives that are getting added, which are at a huge scale with millions of rows on the dimension side.
Millions?
Yeah.
Okay. Sure. Thanks.
The question goes here.
So, if I understand correctly, before, when you have a schema, you're pre-deciding the dimension cuts and the factors, right? So, why not, when the data is being written, stream it using Spark, store your dimensions anyways, and use Impala to query? Because I don't get why the complete orchestration of things.
Okay, so if you're looking over a month's data, I want to actually analyze over a month's of data or a quarter data, right?
Or you can go the Cassandra way also, right?
Impala or Cassandra, they won't solve your batch queries, right? So you'll have to have a system like MapReduce to hit those queries.
Impala will run its own MapReduce
on the queries, right? No, it doesn't. Impala has its own execution engine, which won't go well with batch queries.
Okay. What is the shortage there? What happens? Why? What is the lacuna there?
So, Impala is built to actually solve the interactive queries part, not the batch queries. So, Impala can be one of the drivers that we have, which would answer your interactive queries. So, Grill wants to actually unify your system. So
this is a solve all for both interactive and your
yes.
pre-decided queries, which you want to run in batches and have reporting out.
Yes. So it wants to unify your interactive batch and other dashboard queries and your schedules.
So who's the target audience for Grill? Who uses Grill per se?
Grill is used by everyone who wants to use analytics. So the personas that we have seen in the beginning, like the analysts, business analysts, the product analysts, and the data scientists, or the advertisers, the publishers themselves.
So I'm going to have to stop you there. We're going to go to the person at the back with the question. This is going to be the last question. Can you keep your questions as concise and to the point as possible? Thank you.
Hi. I just want to understand how real-time is your framework? Like how real-time you can integrate events into in this framework?
So we are working on a Spark driver as well here, so which would give you the real-time notion to it. So from the user point of view, it is still the SQL that he's talking, but it can be run with a Spark SQL driver that would build, which can run on a Spark cluster environment, which can answer the real-time queries.
Suppose I just take a real-time scenario, like I want to track the number of times I wait in traffic outside. So can we go that real-time in this framework, or is that a restriction?
Sure. So Grill actually doesn't do much heavy lifting, so it doesn't have an execution engine on its own. It's providing a single interface where you can plug in more engines, plug in more storages. So as long as it can fit into that paradigm, then yes.
Do you have a number?
Like we don't minutes, have that minutes? Engine yet, whatever you're asking about.
Uh-huh.
But yeah.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, that's the time for the questions. You can link with the speaker once you're done with the session, or she will be around for a while. Can we please put our hands together for her? Thank you so much, madam.